Hello everybody, thank you very much for joining me today. I trust you can hear me now. And so, last time, a few weeks ago, I did this. I went through this week in Neo4j and I picked an article and spoke about it, and I thought I'd do the same again this week. So what we're going to be doing this week, I had a look through what came in. So if you go to the Neo4j blog, and what you can do as well, you can also subscribe, and I'll make sure I get the link in the chat for you as well, so that you can subscribe to Neo4j. So this is a weekly newsletter which my colleague Mark Needham puts together, and he goes through and he collates all of the really interesting articles that come up, so what our community have been putting together, also any updates we have to the products and so forth. So these all get added to this, and then so this comes out once a week. It's, you know, a nice quick read, and you know, it's a great opportunity to have a look at something that grabs your fancy and spend some time on it. And I thought, let's pick an article and go through it. So what's really cool is last week Graph Data Science Library 1.3 came out, and one of the major new things that's available in 1.3 is you can now do graph embeddings. So I'll give you a quick high level overview of what graph embeddings are, but you can do those. And my colleague David Voltila has put together an article on working with one of those graph embeddings, so Neo4j tutorial. And I thought, let's go through that. So I'm going to cheat slightly. So we're going to go through the example. I'll show you how to get all the plugins and all that set up with there. I'm going to cheat ever so slightly. I don't have Python set up on this machine, so I will not be doing the end bit. Don't panic. I'll talk through what I am doing, what I'm not doing. So we're mainly going to follow this article that's in this week's edition of Neo4j, and let's get going. So this is the one that was of interest to me. So bringing traditional ML to your Neo4j graph with Neo4j. So effectively what David does here is he talks a little bit about Neo4j. So maybe let's talk about graph embeddings and what are they and why are they so exciting. And oh, and by the way, do fire your questions. If you've got any questions, if something I say doesn't make sense, pop them in the stream chat this week as well. So I am restreaming to YouTube as well, so I've got a little chat window up for that as well. So if you happen to be on YouTube, put your questions in and I'll try and catch them, but I'm most likely going to catch your questions on Twitch, but hopefully I've got an eye on both of those. So if you've got any questions, put them in, I'll try my best to answer them. Okay, so graph embeddings. Why are graph embeddings so exciting? And let's use this lovely diagram here because this helps. So you think about your data and you've got your graph, you've been putting information in. So in this example, we're going to be looking at Les Miserables characters. So you think about, similar to the idea of Game of Thrones, so maybe we can do some Game of Thrones next time, but you think about the graph there and you've got people nodes, and you're going to be talking about people who know other people, so you're going to be connecting those relationships in. And it doesn't have to be just people, maybe there's other things that we collect in our graph. So maybe we're collecting what products get bought with other products. So for example, t-shirts tend to get sold with shorts and sunglasses and sun cream and that kind of thing. So we're going to have all this kind of information and we've been connecting up in the graph, and graphs are really great for being able to capture the different items that we have and how they're connected to each other and, you know, all that kind of good stuff. But the challenge that we have with graphs at the moment is we've put that stuff in, we can query it, and there's a lot of really powerful queries that we can do. But when we start to think about how do we take that data in the graph and do some kind of machine learning pipeline, then it gets a bit interesting, because like, well, what do we take from the graph? How do we represent the graph into something that sort of machine pipeline or any kind of modeling pipeline is going to be able to understand? And if we think about, you know, what does a machine learning model look like? Effectively, what it wants is it wants you to give it a bunch of, you know, effectively inputs. At some point, you'll have trained it. So you'd have said, hey, you know, here's some inputs, and when you get these inputs, this is the result that comes at the end. And then, you know, you use this to train yourself to learn what's going on. And then when I give you some other input data, I want you to take that and then give an output. Now, these expect vectors, these expect matrices of data. And the thing with the graph, whilst we can sort of take a guess at how we're going to flatten it and turn it into a matrix, it becomes this very sparse thing. And actually what we want to do is we want to take these specific features about what our graph is, or maybe we're doing a specific question, so we only want to query part of the graph and we want to do something to it to turn it into something that our models know what to do with. You know, it's, you know, the model expects a vector of numbers it expects a matrix. So what can we do to take our graph and turn it into that? And effectively what graph embeddings do is they say, okay, I'm going to take your graph and you're not telling me anything specific about the graph. I'm going to take your graph or the bit of the graph that you've specified, and I'm going to go away and I am going to sort of study, you know, how you are. I'm going to go away and look at, you know, how the different nodes are connected to each other and that kind of thing. And based on that, I'm going to go off and I'm going to create a representation of that graph that you've specified, and I'm going to turn that into a set of numbers. And these set of numbers, you know, that can be like a vector or a matrix, you know, I don't have these set of numbers, and now I've got this perfect format that this model can go away and take these numbers. So effectively what a graph embedding does is it takes a graph and it translates it into something that these downstream processes can now take. And we've got three graph embeddings that are now available in 1.3 graph data science library, of which one of them is Neo4j. So the thing to specify with these graph embeddings is obviously these have all got different methodologies about how effectively they're going to take your graph and represent it into a series of numbers. So Neo4j works off of the same principle of Word2vec, which is a way of trying to describe how words relate to each other, and how words relate to each other, or the importance of words, will be based on how close they are in sentences. So I'm not going to go into a huge amount of detail as to how that works, but with Neo4j, it uses a similar process, and what it effectively tries to do is, you know, using a random walk, so basically it will randomly sort of traverse around the graph, and it will try and say, well, okay, so this node, it, you know, based on how nodes are related to each other, it'll go away and it'll try and create a representation of that graph in a set of values, and the idea being that that is going to represent how different things are connected to each other and so forth, and the features of the graph. So it's probably worth mentioning as well is it's not going to be like a 100% representation because of the nature of what it is, because you're going to be randomly picking start points, for example, and how you work around the graph. You could run the algorithm several times over different points and you may get different values. That is the nature of it. But it's sort of probably a way of thinking about it is if you think about when you are capturing an image, for example, and you think about, say, JPEG, you know, very popular image formats, you know, when you take a picture, you get a JPEG. So that JPEG isn't going to be 100% of the image that you took, because that image would be very, very, very large if you captured like the millions of different colours that you have and what have you. And, you know, if you've got an HD image and you try to capture everything absolute, you know, this thing would be huge. This would be like sort of gigabytes. Whereas you sort of think about a typical HD pictures, you know, in the low megabytes region. So effectively what's happening is you've got some representations there. So what you're doing is you're making some representations about the colors, you're making some representations about the neighboring pixels, about them being a similar color and so forth. So there's a lot of things that go on when you create the picture, where you are saying, I'm making a representation of what the true image was into something that, you know, you share along. So sort of a rough idea of what's going on there with the graph embeddings. Okay, cool. So that's what's going on. So that's what graph embedding. That's why we're really excited about them, because effectively we can go away and take them and do stuff with them. We've now got them available in 1.3 of the graph data science library. So do go and have a play. And I'm going to go through some of David's blog here so you can see what I'm doing. And please, by all means, have a go at the same time yourselves. I am going to be using Neo4j desktop next time. Actually, I'll have a quick, I'll maybe not in this session, but if you've got the graph data science library in the sandbox, so you probably can do it there. So what I'll do is I'll go away, have a quick test to see running this, and then I'll just ping out a tweet how I did it. So I'll ping that on Twitter. So I'll do it after this session. But anyway, so we've got the blog post here, and we talk about, so David talks about Node2Vec, he talks about graph embeddings, and talks a little bit about what it does. And now we're moving on to the Les Miserables dataset. So, similar idea to Game of Thrones. So the idea is Game of Thrones talks about how the characters interact with each other, and it's the same idea of the Les Miserables dataset. So basically which characters have had contact with other characters and so forth. I have seen the musical, so I am one up from David. So I've read the first book of the Game of Thrones series, and I have seen the Les Miserables musical. So back in the day when we were allowed to go to theatres. So I've a bit, although the memory is a bit rusty. Okay, so we talk about the prerequisite of Neo4j 4.1. So that's probably something worth mentioning now. So if you want to use the GDS library 1.3 with the graph embeddings, you will need to use the 4.x series of Neo4j. So David talks about 4.1, so I'm going to do the same thing. So I've got my Neo4j desktop here. I am going to add 4.1. So let's create that database. And if I have a quick look back at the blog post here, we're going to be using APOC as well. So we need to install the APOC plugin as well as the GDS plugin. So that's really, really easy. Okay, so we've got the graph. So to add the plugins, you just click on the add plugin button. I am going to install, I'm in offline mode. Let me just correct that. So for those of you who find yourselves in offline mode, quick reminder, if you click on the settings cog, you will see an option here that says enable offline mode. If it's ticked and you are online and you want to use the plugins, just click that box and then you'll be back online. Okay, so I'm gonna click on add in plugins. I want to add the APOC install. So give that a moment, and then I'm going to add the graph data science library plugin as well. And let's start the database. Okay, so we're having a look at the data, and it looks like David has kindly provided the JSON for us. So let's have a quick look at that. Okay, excellent, cool. So having a quick look at what we've got the data here. So we've got our nodes, we've got some IDs for them, we've got the labels, so they're all characters. Modularity one, okay. The names of the characters. We've got some relationships as well. Got some weights. And I think we go for the article, but I think the weights represent the number of times those characters have interacted with each other from the book. So, okay, so you've got a relationship describing from which node to which node. Brilliant. Okay, so that's the data. That looks all good. So let's see. Oh, we are up and running. So I'm going to run this from localhost. So you've got two ways how you can run browser. You can either run it from desktop. So what you can do is you click desktop and you click on open, or you can do localhost 7474 from your browser of choice, and you can run Neo4j browser from there as well. So I'm just running it from here, so because I'm switching between the different tabs here, so it's probably a lot easier for you to see what I'm doing if I keep it there. Okay, so coming back to the article, we're going to import some data. So we're using the APOC load JSON function, and there's lots of different things. So if you go into the APOC documentation, you can import XML, you've got the CSV loader as well if you don't want to use the cipher one, you've got JSON and a load of other formats as well you can load. So if you've got some data and you're thinking about, what options do I have to load it? do have a look in the APOC documentation. So we're going to run this and load some data. Fantastic. And we can have a quick look at the data model. So what we're expecting is a person node and that relationship come back into them. There we go. So you've got character node and they've got an appeared with self-referencing into that type of node. Okay, so we've got that data in. And what we can do as well, if we click on here and click on character, there we go. So this that just loads up a sample of 25 and we can see some of the connections there. And the thing to mention here, and this is something you'll probably find, and if you watch the session that I did with Tomáš and Nathan, you'll spot that sometimes this data is captured. And what happens is when we're talking about the number of times that character, you know, a character, or in our case it was animals, have interacted with other animals, we don't always put in a number of relationships. So for example here between Guillemer and Montparnasse. I apologise now if I've butchered the names. I should have picked two. Hang on, I'm going to pick two characters whose names I'm not going to horribly mess up. Okay. Let's do this. There we go. I'm feeling confident with these two. Okay. So if we look, for example, between Javert and Babet, we can see that they've got a weight of 2 with appeared with. And so this is representing that there would be 2 relationships between Babet and Javert, but we don't necessarily, or if we were just trying to represent this as a graph, maybe it makes sense to just have the weight on the relationship. So for example, if we were going to be running some other graph algorithms, or for example, if we wanted to filter and say, well, we only care about characters who've got more than 5 interactions with each other. So for argument's sake, if we were trying to figure out, if we were trying to predict friends of friends or something like that, and let's say you've got, you know, 2 people and they've got 5 common links between them, if they've only met those common links like once, then we might go, there's a good likelihood that those 2 people don't know each other, because yes, they've got 5 common contacts, but they themselves have only met those 5 common contacts once each. So, you know, maybe it's a really big meetup or something and they've forgotten their faces. So maybe it's not very likely that they know each other. But if the 5 people that they've got in common they've met, you know, more than 10 times, then it's probably a very good likelihood that they know each other. So that's why we would, you know, maybe we'd capture the weights, you know, number of times they've met each other as weights on the relationships, rather than having a number of relationships. However, for the purposes of what we're going to do here, where we're doing this node effect, this graph embedding, and due to the nature of how it works, it's not going to be looking at the weights on the relationships. What it's going to be doing is it's going to be looking at how many relationships are coming off different nodes. So things like having, you know, 2 nodes having sort of 20 relationships is, you know, they're going to say that those nodes are quite close to each other, you know, or, you know, whatever the embedding output is. So that's relevant information. So what David talks about in his post is that we're going to need to effectively go through and put those relationships in. So before I go ahead of myself, let's have a look at what he does here. So talking about, we've loaded our data, we've had a quick peek at what that looks like. And yes, so this is an undirected graph, but and if you think about interactions, sorry, there's a question coming. I'll come back to the question on YouTube in a second. So something to mention about with loading. So whilst the appeared with, we don't have a direction, because you always need to load relationships will be very directional to begin with, but when you're querying the data, you don't need to take account of that relationship. So the relationship direction only matters if you want it to matter. So whilst we load the data with a direction, we're going to ignore that for the purposes of what we do next. Okay, so we've got a question that's come up. String, query string could be updated dynamically as you interact with the graph. I'm not sure what you mean by that. So if you can provide a bit more detail and I'll come back to you on that. Okay. So if we continue with this, so we've got note of ec, we've got a number of settings that we do with this. So embedding size, the number of dimensions, the resulting feature, return factor, likelihood of return parameter of node, in out factor, bias parameter, how likely the random walk will explore distant nodes, and walk length. Okay, so we've got a number of settings that we may necessarily set. So we'll talk about those, we'll have a look at those in a second. So the thing that we probably care a lot about is the embedding size, so I'll come to that in a second. Okay, so this is effectively what we're going to be using. So we're going to be doing an anonymous graph projection. So I'll talk about that in a second. So let's have a look. So effectively what David talks about here is he's looking to reproduce Grover and Leskovets' findings in looking at their data. So effectively what they do is they're effectively trying to use k-means clustering to find sort of different groupings in Lemmas. So don't worry, I'll talk a little bit about what k-means is if you've not come across that before. And so effectively what did they demonstrate in this paper? That they're looking at homophily. So this is about grouping, you know, nodes together that are similar. So an example here, this is about sort of finding sort of neighborhoods of the same grouping. So individuals that are likely to sort of be gathering together, so groups, and structural equivalence. So do they have the same relationships or lack of other with other nodes? So one is like trying to find natural groupings together, and one of them is trying to find those with common relationships. So this is effectively the findings there. So we're probably not going to go down this far route to do this. I will leave it to you all to have a go with yourselves, but I'll talk a little bit about what's going on, and I'm going to cheat. So for example, effectively David uses Python to go through and pull and run k-means. I'm going to talk a bit about what k-means, how it works, and I'm going to just pull together a quick chart in Excel. So I'll talk for what's going on. So we talk about Les Mis, and they're talking about finding a concept of bridge characters that span subplots in Les Mis. So basically, who are the bridge characters that are joining? So you know you've got like the key different plots going on in Les Mis. Here are the characters that kind of help join those bits together. Okay. So let's get going with this. So we've got the characters. I am going to leave this. We've got this in the diagram. So we've got the two characters and they appear. And what we, and this is again, this is what David talks about. So for the purposes of this, for us to run Note2Vec, what we need is we need to represent each of those interactions as an extra relationship. So what we're going to do here, and let's talk through the query. So again, this is coming back to the idea that, you know, you've got, you know, those characters with lots and lots of, you know, interactions with each other should have lots of relationships. And that's probably going to start to, you know, that's going to start showing us, you know, so certain characters that probably, you know, belong together, like the ones that are grouped together because they've got similar relationships. And then maybe the characters who've got lots of sort of very few interactions, but they've got interaction with lots of different characters, those are probably our bridging characters that are showing us how the different sort of scenes join together. So what we're going to do is we're going to run this and we're going to create those relationships. So you know how we talked about before, like Babé and Javert have a weight of 2, so we want to turn all of those weights into the relationships between them. So if we have a look at the query here, so then we're matching the characters, so that character paired with another character, and then what we're going to do is we're taking, so this range, this is effectively going to create us an array of numbers from 1 to the weight. In this example here, it's going to go at 1 to 2. And then we're going to create this new, we can create these number of relationships based on like how many items in that array. So basically we're going to go round in each of those arrays. So here we've got weight of 2, so that's going to create two relationships of unweighted appeared with, and we've got one here. Oh, 2, wait, 1... Oh my goodness, we've got none here with an imp- I'm hoping we've got like one with the, there we go, 9. So that we got here, we've got weight 9, that's going to create 9 relationships between those two. Cool, so let's do that. Let's run this. Excellent. So we've created another 820 relationships, whereas previously we had, did we show how many? Yeah, so previously we loaded 254. So that 254, when we unwind and think about the different relationships we've got in there, it became 820. Excellent. Okay, on we go. So if we, yeah, we can, let's do this. So now we can have a look at this brought back. So I don't do it on all of them because it'll be big and all, but you can see here. So now we've got those four. So where we had the weight of 4, we've now got those 4 relationships. Brilliant. Okay, so let's have a look what's going on here. So now we're going to be running the algorithm. So let's just talk a little bit about different ways that you can run the graph data science algorithms. So you've got a number of options. So what it does, it works on this idea of creating a graph projection. And then with that graph projection, you then say what function you want to run. So for example, maybe let's come back to the example of we're talking about say a customer buys a product. So let's say we've got customer node and we've got product node, and we've got something about customer buys a set of products and then another customer buys a set of products. And effectively what we're doing is we're saying, well, actually, you know, a customer buys a bunch of products together. So they buy a t-shirt, they buy shorts together, they buy a baseball cap because, you know, summer holidays, or, you know, let's say it's the winter time. So they buy ski boots, they buy ski socks, they buy waterproof trousers because, you know, they're going skiing. So certain things may be grouped together. And let's say we want to do some kind of sort of community detection on products that are bought together so that we can start to create like grouping so that we know what products to recommend based on communities or something like that. So what we might do is we might create a projection of all the products because we're not interested in the customers, but what we are interested in is using the customer as like a pivot point to show us how the products are connected. So what we could do is we could create a projection, and this projection we put into memory, and then we run our graph algorithms off the back of that. And you've got 3 ways of doing this. So you can do a native projection. So this is where you don't actually need to do any kind of work to your data. In fact, you've already done some pre-processing to your data in the database, and then you just say, hey, bring up these labels, bring up these relationships, and, you know, you're good to go. You've got another, which is a cipher projection, which is maybe something we may have used in the example I talked about where we've got product and customer, where we say, okay, what you need to do is, yes, the data is like this on the database, but we're just going to reshape that data so that, for example, we write a query that tells the, you know, that effectively what loads the projection into memory is we're saying that actually, yes, I know I've got customer buys product A and customer buys product B, but take that customer and turn that into a relationship and pretend that actually there's a direct relationship between product A and product B. And then again, we load that projection into the graph. And the third option is an anonymous projection, which is happening here. So the, and again, it's depending on what you want to do. So the advantage of loading a projection via either the native projection or the cipher projection is if you want to run your graph algorithm a number of times, you want to try out different thresholds, different parameters, and, you know, you load that graph once and then you keep going. If you're just experimenting or you're not using a huge amount of data, then what you can do is do an anonymous projection, and this is what's happening here. And what happens with the anonymous projection is it'll go away, and then each time you run the algorithm, it basically goes away, it pulls the relevant part of the graph into memory, runs your graph algorithm, and then it's done. So it's great if you're just doing one off, or you've got a small graph. If you've got quite a large graph, or you want to test out lots of parameters, or you're trying out different graph algorithms on the same amount of data, then you may use the cipher or the native projection to load your graph into memory, and then you just do it once, and then you know it's in memory and just keep running into different things. So that's just the different things going on. And here, this is an example of an anonymous one. So what we're going to be doing is we're just going to look every time we run this algorithm, we're loading our graph into memory and then running it. So let's just go through what's going on here. So this is called GDS. So yes, we have got the graph embeddings now in 1.3, but these are the alpha tier algorithms. And what that means is they're not what we call the production ready algorithms. So absolutely, they're really useful, but it's just to be aware that maybe there may be some changes, maybe in the next version of GDS, there may be some sort of tweaks that apply to those. So it's really useful and you can use them, but there are certain features that you get with the non-alpha, non-beta versions of the algorithm that you're not going to get here. So just be warned that there might be some changes or some adaptations in future versions of this. Okay, so we've got here, so we're talking about the node projections. We've got character, so we know that's the label that we've got on our nodes, and we want to bring in the unweighted appeared with the relationship. So those are the new relationships that we generated. So each one of those per weights that we had in the original relationship data that we imported, and orientation undirected. So we're not interested in the direction. Direction's not important. Okay, so we've got some of the features in here. So what did we say? We said that the return factor, let's go back up and have a look at our, so likelihood of returning the prior node into random factor. So okay, we'll have a look at the paper in a second to have a look at the relevance of the weightings, because I don't know if that's 0 to 1 or some other weighting. And we had in out factor, how likely. So again, let's have a quick look if we've got the, let's pull up the, let's bring this up. Do we have a quick mention? Okay, we'll have a look at the paper in a tick. Okay, so I just want to check what the relevance of those two are. But the next one that is interesting is the embedding size. So this is the number of dimensions that we return. And so let me talk a little bit about what's going on here. So let's go back to the JPEG example or an image in general. I think this is, whilst obviously they're not the same, I think some of the principles sort of help carry. And if you think about an image and you think about the color schemes that you have, and maybe you're going to use a small number of colors, so maybe you've got like an 8-bit image or a 16-bit image, or if you think about, you know, how you used to have like sort of the sort of old school sort of really 80s bitmaps where you've got 256 colors. So effectively, the embedding size, so this is the number of dimensions that you're using, or you're telling the algorithm to use to try and represent your graph. And there's that thing around trying to think, what is the number of dimensions that is the best sort of, what is the best sort of choice between providing accurate representation or a good enough representation of your graph versus the model that you're using. So for example, so each of these are inputs. So for example, if you think about, you've got an image, and let's say it's a bitmap, and you could either have a bitmap of a photo and you have, you know, sort of your 2 million colors per pixel, and that's going to look quite good, but that's quite big. Versus you might say, well, actually what I'm going to do is I'm going to downscale that to 256 colors. And obviously the pro side of that is that your image is going to be a lot smaller. However, you lose some fidelity of your image, or use a lot of fidelity of your image, especially if it's a photo, because, you know, all of a sudden all these colors are going to clump together. You're not going to have sort of 1,000 different representations for blue or something like that. So you're losing the number of colors available. However, the pro side of that is that your image is a lot smaller. And so thinking about this from a perspective of you're going to take this data and load it into your model, the more dimensions that you have, so the more number of sort of vectors, these input features you need to put into your model, the more you need with regards to like sort of test data. So just an example, so if you've got like two dimensions, you've got two input vectors going into your model, then maybe you're going to need roughly, for argument's sake, maybe you need about 10 things to sort of like potentially to sort of like train your model, and then you've got a number of features. Don't hold me to that, this is just an example. But as soon as you introduce like a third input vector, then you need to like sort of think, you're needing to now think about sort of tripling to like sort of going a power up to your test data. You've got four input vectors, again you need significantly more, and what you'll find is you'll have this exponential increase, that the more input features you have, the more you need with regards to your test data to train your model, like your training data to train your model, your test data to test it, and that kind of thing. So there is that subtle thing about picking the number of input, the number of dimensions you're going to do. But of course, coming back to the image idea as well, is the fewer input vectors you have, that you run the risk of you missing things. So maybe there's some sort of depth in there that you lose by reducing the number of input vectors. So again, coming back to our image example, so if you've got an image and you've got 2 million colours, but the image you've got is say a floor plan of a building, you know, and that's sort of, you know, typically a monochromatic colour, then yeah, you could probably really shrink down the number of colours you use to represent that, and you'd still keep the key features, you'd still be able to look at that image and know what it is. Whereas, you know, maybe you keep it down to like sort of 4 to 8 colours, and you still know that it's a floor plan, and you'd be able to discern the floor plan and what have you. Whereas if you've got a photo of, say, I'm trying to think of a busy picture, so let's say of a jungle with lots of bird species in there, then reducing your colours down to 8, you lose the information there. And so there's that balance about picking the dimensions. So that's what's going on there. So again, that's sort of something to think about when you're doing this. So in the paper, and this is David's recreating the settings that they've done for the data. So he's using these features. So let's run this and see what happens. So we've got 16 dimensions. So what this means is that for each value that comes back, so we're going to be getting a set of, again, a vector for each node, and that vector is effectively trying to represent what that graph is, or what the nodes are to that graph. So let's run this. And there we go. So what I'm going to do is I'll just quickly export this to CSV. So this is great if you want to go straight away and work with some data. Just make this a bit smaller so it fits in the screen. So you can see, so this is the output. So for each of the node IDs, this is now the embedding that has been generated for those nodes. And another way of thinking about these, so let me just quickly prettify this a bit. So let's do, actually, I'm going to just replace the brackets and I'm just going to text the columns this. So you see here, we've now got these 16. So remember, we put in 16 dimensions, so it's given us 16 dimensions to represent each node at this flattened state as part of the graph embedding. And the best, you know, again, if you're trying to think about sort of, you know, what does this mean? So if you think about, if you were plotting two points, you've got X and Y. So it's almost like, well, this would be X, this would be Y, and then these are the other 14 dimensions. So this could be a Z plot, and then you can see all these plots. So effectively, you can take this, I'm not going to do this, I'm going to do a quick example with two dimensions. But effectively, we're now saying, you know, in 16 dimensions, this is how we'd represent all of these points and how they sit together. So let's move on to k-means. And what k-means does, well, let's go back to block place and I can bring back the Excel. So this is what we've done. We've gone away. This is the data we've come back. So again, as David talks about here, is, you know, if you rerun this, you're going to get different values. That's expected because you're randomly picking different start points. You're randomly trying to decide how you go down the route. So whilst if I took those 16 points and plotted them out, they should roughly be the same how they come out. They're not going to be exactly the same, and that's okay. It's much like, again, coming back to the image where you're trying to decide where you're going to quantize your pixel colors and that kind of thing. Okay, so we've got these numbers, and what I'm going to do in a bit is I'm going to redo this with two dimensions, and I'm going to do an XY scatter graph so you can get an idea of how we're starting to represent these points and have a visual view of it. Okay, so David now goes on to talk about using k-means, and he uses Python for this. So I don't have Python set up, but please do go away, have a play with it. But let's talk a little bit about what k-means does. So you've got an idea of why it was really powerful to get these graph embeddings, getting these values of our graph and then doing things. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to rerun this, and I'm going to run it with dimensions of 2, and I'm going to do a chart, an XY scatter chart. Okay, so now we've got our two dimensions. I am going to export this as CSV, and I'm going to open this up in Excel. Right, and same idea again. I'm just going to quickly clean this up. So I'm going to replace. So remember how we talked about we had those 16 dimensions, and we're trying to plot each of those points in 16 dimensions. So each plot point here would be a dimension. So what I'm going to do here is I've reduced it down to 2. So it's probably wholly inaccurate and in, you know, not so representative of the data as having 16 dimensions, but you start to get an idea of what's going on. So let me just sort of text to columns this. Okay, so again, so we've got these nodes here, and now we're representing this graph across two dimensions for all the nodes. And what I can do is if I take this and now plot this, oops, there's an XY scatter. Oh, that's not what I wanted. There we go. Cool. So what we're effectively doing here is we're, oh, let's take this chart up a bit higher. So this is where it's really powerful if we start thinking about it. So effectively, this was our graph. So you think about what we had. So let's for a dramatic effect, let's bring back part of this graph. And this is now gonna have loads of relationships because we've put them in. So we've got our graph here, and we look at some of these. Some of these characters have got lots of relationships. Some of them have fewer. And effectively, we've taken that, we've run this graph embedding, and we've now reduced it down to 2 dimensions because I've asked for 2 dimensions. And what we can do now is we can take that, these 2 dimensions, and I can now plot them. So same way as I can take this and feed this into some kind of, some kind of a model, I can take these values and plot them. And I'm not going to plot it over 16 because that'd be really hard to visualize, but I'm plotting them over 2, and I've taken them from Excel. And then straight away you can start to see, well, okay, this is interesting. So I've got my 75 nodes. I've got my 75 nodes here, and I now have a way to plot this into a chart. And straight away you can start to see interesting things. Where you can see, look, well, there's a group here, and this could either be 2 groups or 1 group. But you can see like a tight knit set of nodes here. You've got a more scattered group of nodes here. You've got some sort of groupings here. So straight away you can start to take that and think of different ways that you can represent this. So let's talk a little bit about k-means and what k-means does. So what K means does is a way, it's a machine learning algorithm, and what it does is it tries to figure out what nodes, what points, what things belong with other things. So what are the groups together? And do you notice here how I sort of mentioned we've got these groups that are starting to sort of group together, and we see this interesting thing going in here. So what k-means does is it tries to say, well, okay, these group of nodes, they probably belong in a community, so let's call it community one for argument's sake. These ones belong together, so they're probably community two. These ones belong together, they're community three, and so forth. And then it just tries to assign each node into a community. And you might say, well, I expect four communities, for example. And then it'll go, well, okay, so you're saying there's going to be four communities. So when you run this algorithm, it's going to randomly assign every single point. So let's say four, we're saying four in this example here. So it's going to randomly assign every single point that we have to one of these communities. And when it assigns that, so once it's done that, then what it will do, it will say, well, okay, so how far apart are you from the average distance of that community? So what you will do is, for everything that's been assigned, you're going to work out what the average distance is. So again, you sort of think about back to sort of your rule of Pythagoras that you sort of did at school. You're working out the distance between all of them, and each of those is going to have an average. You're going to work out what the average distance is for each community and how far each point is away from that community. So just as an example, so let's say here, let's say we start off and this node here turns out to be where the average center is for this community, and you'll go, well, hang on a minute, this is what we started off with saying is the average community, so now let's work out for each one of this community how far away are from the average. And then you're going to be looking at the average distance from other communities, and then what you're going to do is you're going to keep going, well, actually the sort of the average center of the community is probably here, and you keep iterating and it's probably further up. And what you're trying to do is you're trying to work out again across these 16 dimensions. So I've only got two here, but you're thinking across the 16 dimensions, you're effectively trying to figure out where the average sort of home is across those 16 dimensions of each of these four communities that we've said there's four communities. We think there's four communities, find out the four communities. And then what you'll do is, so let's say we started off by saying that this node here had been randomly assigned to this community. Eventually what will happen is it will go, well, actually the distance, this node here is closer to the average here for this community than it is for that community. So we're now going to move that node. We originally assigned you to, so let's say this is community one, community two, community three, community four. Well, we originally assigned you to community one, but you make more sense to be here in community two. And that's what k-means is doing. It's trying to sort of find based on the distances, and these are I know here we've got 2D, but you can do distances across as many dimensions, and then that's what it tries to do. It tries to figure out, you know, where are the averages, you know, average locations across these dimensions for the communities, and then for each node, do you fit in this community or do you fit in another community based on how far away you are from that average community location, and that keeps iterating through until they all fit. So that's k-means. I'm not doing that, but I'm just showing you as a very quick, you can very quickly see how that might work and how you randomly assign that, and you can see the power of running a graph embedding. And again, I've just done it over two dimensions. I've probably lost a huge amount of information about what's going on, but visually you can start to see the power of doing that.